take you to the 29. Did you make any personal observations of any problems or interaction with Henry Pecor or Blake or any of their significant others on the 29?
Yes, sir, I did.
And would you tell the court about that?
Yes, sir. The afternoon of the 29th, after we went back home, I was standing in my son's north driveway area out of his house, and Roger and either Gary or Bruce with him walked by, and I heard Roger say specifically, "We got guns. We got shotguns. All we got's legal." And then he mumbled something else and proceeded to walk on down the road. And then they turned around and came back. And that was the most prominent thing that I heard that stuck in my mind. I went, and that afternoon I told my son. I said, "Son, I said, you need to be careful, because I just heard him say that they got guns and they got shotguns."
Now, at that point in time, before the injunction, there was a temporary injunction that was put in place, and your son's firearms were removed from his home, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
And what happened with those firearms?
I took them to my house and kept them under lock and key.
Once the injunction was dissolved by Judge Moxley, what, if anything, did you do with any of those firearms?
That evening, after supper, somewhere in the 7 o'clock time frame, I brought them back to him.
What specifically did you bring back?
I specifically brought a Ruger 6-inch nickel-plated 357 revolver and a Beretta Model 92 9mm.
And why did you bring those back? Why did you bring this back?
I brought this back for his protection, for him to protect himself, because I couldn't be there all the time.
Okay. And at the time that you brought him back, had you already had this conversation with him about what you overheard Roger and Bruce, Tim Blake, say, or was that after? Just give me a sequence of events in terms of the return.
I heard Roger make his statement
at this point in time, because everything they may have said is hearsay. Well, I just wasn't sure where this was going, but that's all hearsay.
Well, there was no objection made. It's in evidence, and I'm not asking him to repeat it. I'm asking him for a timeline.
Well, is there? You can ask him for a timeline. How's he can repeat a timeline? He can talk about what he did.
That's what I'm asking. I don't understand the objection. There's no objection when I ask him what they said. I then ask him two more questions. I'm now asking him to put his conversation with his son, where he told him about what he had overheard, in a timeline of when he returned the firearms.
And so what's
that's the question that's on the table.
What's the objection to that?
He can testify to what he heard. Passing it on to his son is hearsay.
He's not being asked about what he told his son at this point. He's asked about time when certain things happen. So if that's what he's being asked, that objection's over.
Thank you. Now, again, could you provide the court a timeline between the time you had the conversation and you returned the guns?
Yes, sir. Somewhere in the afternoon, between 3:30 and 6, I heard Roger say...
No, don't repeat. I just want a timeline.
I heard Roger make the statement. I told my son about it before we went to supper. After we came back from supper, I went home and retrieved the weapons and gave them back to him.
Were there any other instances that you specifically saw regarding Roger, Tim Blake, or Gary Embry interaction with any member of your family?
None that I specifically recall. It was a daily jumble of sounds and words coming from over there.
I want to specifically show you...
Let me put the screen down. I didn't realize you had that.
First of all, sir, and this is part of defendants, too. This is the videos that we have put into evidence. Do you recognize the scene depicted in this video?
Yes, sir.
And this purports to be 8/29/2012, the morning of that particular day. Do you recognize the truck that's there?
Yes, sir, that's my son's truck.
Okay. Let me stop this for just a moment. There appear to be, let me know what happened to the laser pointer. I just want to back that. I'm still with Mr. Bailey. Oh, well, they're looking for the laser pointer in a good old fashioned way. There appear to be a number of people right about there. Can you tell me, either from your recollection or from looking at the video, who those people would be?
No, sir, not right off hand.
Okay, fair enough. The only reason I'm confused, and I'm not arguing with you, but I thought that you were
this bad.
Well, I heard them say stuff.
Yes, stuff too.
I mean, no, before you put
me. But he's talking about walking across from their house, and that was there's nothing before this segment of the video about
that. Okay. Well, glad to hear heart's content. No.
Pull up something they gave me that I thought was really interesting because I think it was really
Jumps 12 to 12:10 to 12:40. Jumps
Mr. Asminger, we were working on another clip out of Defendant's Exhibit 2, the hard drive, and this one is...
This is the same one, I believe. I think we're up to where...
August 29th, 12:41.
Yes.
All right, very good.
Let me pause it there for a moment. There, the video that was provided to us, we provided to the state, jumps from 1210 to 1240. Do you have any knowledge as to why that happened?
I think that happens when the cards filled up. Barbara wasn't able to get home and recycle them to download them and then zero them out and put it back in the machine. And that time frame is about when she came home, she got cleaned up, got some new clothes on, and then she started the video back over again.
Okay. Now, just out of... is that the gap that is missing from there, where you believe that the tape was full? Is that when this alleged conversation happened with the gun, or did that happen at some other time?
No, sir. That should have happened later on.
Okay.
Any time from probably 1, 2 o'clock on.
Okay. Well, I want to ask you about this for right now.
Electronic mixing with electronic on this thing. I don't recognize who it was.
Can you classify it as whether or not it was any member of your family or whether it was coming from the Hembry, Blake, etc.?
As loud as it was, it may have been coming from our area right in there.
Yeah.
But I couldn't say for sure right now. I was going to say, but let's just knock it off, all right? You know, It's just, it's done, it's to stop it. And I'm not exactly sure what my words were, but they were in reaction to what I was hearing when we got out of the car.
Well, what was occurring when you got out of the car, best of your recollection?
As soon as we got out of the car, the yelling and screaming began over in the other yard, and it was directed at my son, and my son said something to them, and then I, as my wife was getting him on inside, I walked over and said something to him in reaction to the to what we were hearing. But you wait till we get, we got you now, or... Wait, why did you see what we have for you now? That kind of thing was going on.
for the verdict jury.
Why were we given that?
Why were we listening to
it? Am I looking for something?
I'm looking for the portion where I believe that Mrs. Ann Woodward, the mother of the defendant, Mr. Woodward, and their neighbor were standing. That is the time when I have been advised that they overheard this exchange. Judge, but the problem is, because of the microphone location, some things are very close to the microphone, some things are farther away. And I don't want to miss relevant information because some of it is closer. Now, sir, let me ask you, we've seen is that you go off camera and then later come back in camera and have a conversation with your son. Is that the time period that you're talking about that you heard the other thing, or should we be looking for something else?
No, sir. You'll notice in the upper right corner of the picture when Roger and Gary Bruce and a dog start down the road, that's when they got in front of the house and said that.
Okay. So I'm going to keep playing it. Do you think it's close to this period of time?
I almost think it's later on, sir.
Can you give me a time frame so we can get it closer?
By my inclination, I don't have anybody walking down the street walking dogs till 5:40 in the afternoon.
That might be it.
All right. Well, let's move ahead to 5:40 and see if we can recognize that.
Because it was starting
right
now.
You're at 1 o'clock.
Right, so I want 117.
17:40:10.
17:40:10. Let's see if I can get it to 17:40, and we'll see if that's the right one.
Robert.
at 1740?
1740, 10. That's your two people. You'll see two people coming out under walking dogs.
Okay.
You have to turn the volume way up because there's no such comment.
And let me stop that for a moment. Is this the time frame that you're talking about?
I think so. You would hear myself and the neighbors talking.
Okay. Sir, that's the time period that you believe that the conversation took place?
Yes, sir.
Now, it's a good time to talk about that. The camera setup and microphone, that was attached to the house, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Now, that wouldn't necessarily pick up any normal conversation from some distance away, would it?
Not to the side.
We can hear it when they're yelling and screaming, correct?
Yes, sir.
Less so when they're talking from a distance away.
Right.
Or less so even when members of your family are away from the house, correct?
I'm down to the side.
So, despite the fact that the microphone did not pick up their conversation, first of all, was the conversation that you overheard, was it a loud conversation or was it a normal conversation? About what they were saying.
When I heard Roger walk by, his conversation was in a normal tone of voice. We were probably separated by 15 feet. And it was a normal tone of voice where he said, we got guns, we got shotguns, everything we got's legal. And then he kept walking. And he was just about past the end of the driveway when he started that. That could have been out of range of the microphone pointed straight ahead.
Okay. Notwithstanding whether or not it was captured by the microphone in the surveillance, You related that conversation as you heard it to your son, correct?
Yes, sir. I did.
Can you tell the court who the people that are standing around the corner by the police car are?
I think one of them is Bruce, and I think one of them is Roger. I think Gary was standing a little bit further back, and I think Mrs. Blake might have been in there fairly close to.
Are you saying that because you can identify them on the video, or you're using your memory about what you believe occurred?
Both, Your Honor.
Okay, well, tell me.
I do remember that scene.
Tell me what it is about that person to the far right on the corner that most looks like a person instead of a gray blob, and tell me what it is about them that...
The one standing out in the road, right. That's the police officer.
How do you know that?
The one sitting...
No, how do you know that? How do you know that it's a police officer?
I watched him get out of the car.
Well, see, this is recollection, not identification on the video, right? Are you telling me that you can tell that that person standing there is a police officer if you hadn't have been there?
By the video, yes, sir. Yeah, I can see his uniform.
Right now?
I was a lot closer when I watched it.
I'm not sure for the purpose of this hearing why it makes any difference whether the witness is testifying from their recollection or whether they're testifying from viewing something that's in evidence. Both are equally in evidence.
It might not really. It's just that I can't. Sometimes you're asking questions that makes me believe that the person in the witness chair can actually recognize some person's feature or description, which I don't think anybody realistically thinks that any witness can do that. If they're testifying from their recollection, because they were there and they remember who the people are, then perhaps that's a distinction that needs to be made. But
I thought that the witness explained to the court that it was a combination of those things. They were testifying from their memory, and then they're applying their memory to the video.
Well, that's what I got out of it. If that's what they're doing, that's fine with me. It's just that...
Well, let me clarify that with the witness.
I'm having a hard time understanding how anyone could identify anyone in those pictures if that's all they're doing, just looking at them.
Sir, let me clarify that. When I ask you to identify that and you're looking at these these different things, even though the picture is bad. Can you testify based on your recollection from being there and then looking at the scene so that you can tell the court who those people are? Or are you trying to identify them straight from the picture?
Yes, sir. I identified them by actually being there that evening.
Thank you.
you recognize yourself in that photo? Can you recognize and point out to the court, either from your memory or from the video, do you see yourself now entering that video?
Do I see myself in that one?
Yes, sir.
No, sir.
Who's the gentleman right next to the police officer, if you know?
I don't think that's me. I don't remember walking down here.
Okay. Where were you? You said that you had deserted the scene. Where were you?
Standing back up here behind, off the corner of the house.
Yeah.
six were on scene there for, give or take, 25 minutes. At any point in time, did either of those two police officers ever try to talk with you, your son, your son's wife, or your wife?
No, sir.
Just talk with them and then left?
Yes, sir.
Is that fairly typical of the way the Titusville Police Department responded to the call?
Yes. No objection, sir. No objection.
How do you know it?
Based on those calls where you were present, where they responded, is it typical of how they handled it?
Objection again, Judge.
He can testify about what they did if he made an observation, but he can't.
They didn't even wait 10 seconds before the police left before they started it up again. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Thank you. get your son over here?
I'm sorry, Greg.
Could you recognize the voice of the person that was yelling, get your son over here?
No, sir, I didn't recognize them, just that they were males' voices.
You had earlier said that you were standing slightly off camera observing this, correct?
Yes, sir. And at some point, that's 1917, at some point in that time frame, plus or minus an hour or two, I went to dinner and then came back.
Okay, that's fine. I want to kind of address this moment in time right here, where we heard them again yelling comments that appear to be directed toward you regarding your son. Where is Billy when this is happening?
As far as I know, Billy was inside. Okay. Tried to keep him inside the rest of the day.
Okay. So Billy's not interacting with these people at all during this period of time. He's inside. He's not even out where they can see him while they're directing these comments toward you.
Correct.
Loud enough to be picked up by the microphone.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
This is going to demonstrate is pretty much continually about 22:15. I can move it because it's kind of indistinct shouting, but it's continuous during that period of time. At 22:15, we can hear something on the headphones. We're not sure how well it's going. Actually, the point of this is from the time that the police arrived and left, this is the night of the incident, that pretty much nonstop with varying...
I'm sorry, this isn't the night of the shooting.
I'm sorry, a night of the injunction. I misspoke. Night of the injunction.
Correct.
pretty much nonstop through this period of time until the police are called again that this sort of behavior... is continuing.
Well, I stipulate that.
I think all of your witnesses have said that as well.
Thank you.
sir, you testified a few moments ago that after this period of time, at some point in this range, you leave for a period of time and go to dinner. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
You had... Did the Titusville Police Department ever re-respond while you were there that evening?
After I came back that evening, yes.
Okay. About what time did you return that evening?
It was dark, so it was after 8:30 or so, about 8:30.
Was the Titusville Police Department already there at that time, or did they arrive after you got back?
I don't honestly remember if the officer was sitting there at the table when I walked in or if he came after I got there. I honestly don't remember. I remember him sitting at the table, that's all.
Okay. Did you have any conversation with the Titusville Police Department?
Yes, I did.
That night?
Yes, sir.
Tell the court what you related to the Titusville Police officer that night.
I told the officer what I heard that afternoon when Roger walked by and said he had shotguns and guns and everything he had was legal. And I said, I'm very concerned about my son's safety and his family's safety. I said, my grandchildren are over here, my son's wife, my son. I said, what? I said, there's got to be something we can do. You guys can't stay here. And to my recollection, he asked my son, he said, well, do you have your guns? And my son said, no. And he said, well,
Judge, I'm going to object. This is all hearsay.
Any exception?
No. Based on what the officer said to you and your son, did you take any action?
Yes, I did.
What was the action you took?
I went out and got his guns from my truck and brought them in while the officer was there and gave them to him.
And you did that in front of the Titusville police officer?
Yes, sir.
Party, I'm going to talk about them, and the Henry party received any instructions in terms of the timing of them leaving?
Yes, sir. Our party was instructed to remain in the in our courtroom where we were possession for the hearing. We were told to remain there while the other parties left the area, and that's all I remember them telling us.
Did you follow that instruction?
Yes, sir.
How long did you wait there? Waiting for the other party to leave the area?
About 15 minutes.
Okay. After waiting 15 minutes, what did you and your party do?
We were escorted out on the steps by the bailiffs that were present. They came and got us out of the room and said, okay, it's okay to leave now. And they escorted us down to the steps, and we got on the sidewalk to go to our vehicles.
What happened as soon as you got on the sidewalk of the court?
My son was probably 20 or 30 steps in front of me going south on the west sidewalk in front of the old courthouse in Titusville. And all of a sudden I heard a voice coming from across the street and said, hey, you, look what we got now. Hey, brain dead, look what we got for you now. And I turned and looked, and Gary was standing over there with his cell phone up. And I knew my son heard it. He turned his head and across the street he went. So I followed him across the street. He immediately engaged Gary. And
tell me what you mean by engaged. Verbally, physically, what?
It was a fist fight. Pretty much one-sided, but it was a fist fight. It was a fight, physical confrontation. And when I got to my son, he was still engaged in the altercation. I placed my hand on his back so that I knew where he was, and I looked around to make sure we didn't have anybody else in the area. I was for protection more than anything. During that few seconds that it happened, somebody walked up, and I saw an arm come over and sprayed my son in the eyes with a pepper something, some kind of spray. And I reached up, grabbed his arm, and I pulled him out of the way, and I said, this is not your place. Leave. And I continued to hold my hand on my son to know so that I knew where he was while I looked around to make sure he was not going to get blindsided from somewhere. At that time, my wife and Billy's wife arrived, and they tried to get Billy, or they got Billy away, and he was already trying to get his eyes cleared out. And Gary and his girlfriend was there. She picked his cell phone up off the ground, and the bailiffs had gotten there by this time and taken Gary and girlfriend over to the steps of the courthouse, and they took Billy and I directly west across the street to a wall that separates the Brevard room from the old courthouse. It's out on the sidewalk, and that's where we stayed while the paramedics from the Titusville Fire Department came and helped him clean his eyes out and checked everybody to make sure everything was okay. And we went home.
Anything else happened that night? Now, when you said you went home to your home or you went to Billy's home?
We went to my home. I believe we went to my home first because I changed clothes. I was in my shorts and T-shirt when you saw me in that other about 12-something. Went to my house, I changed. We went over to Billy's house so he could change, and then we were going to go get a lunch. And sometime before that, Barbara arrived at the house. And like I said, that was a gap in there.
That's the segment that we saw through there.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. So anything that we haven't either seen on video or talked about so far occur on the day of the injunction hearing?
Anything?
Anything happened of any significance that I haven't covered on the day of the injunction?
Yes, sir. Very significant was on a Saturday afternoon, I believe it was, and the day of the injunction, no, sir.
Okay. After the injunction, did you continue to go over to your son's house on a regular basis?
Yes, sir.
Was there anything else that you observed in terms of interaction with Henry, Blake, McCord, and or their significant others and your son and or his family?
None. No interaction.
Okay. You're about to tell me something that happened on a Saturday.
Yes, sir.
About that. What, first of all, do you recall the date of that Saturday?
The date?
Yes.
I believe it was the 18th.
All right. What happened on the 18th?
About 7:30 that evening, we'd gone to supper, and we were in the car coming back to his house. We had other family from out of town that was visiting with us. And my son called and said, "Dad, I think they called the police on me again. Can you come over?" I said, "Yes, we'll be there in a few minutes." So we got there about 7:35 in the evening. And the police officer had walked up and was talking to my son. When I got out of the car, I walked up to listen in. And she asked me for the injunction papers. They were still in effect at that time, temporary injunction. And she asked me for the injunction papers.
I'm confused. I thought this was since the injunction. They went back in time,
prior to that.
Right? I have to admit that I was confused, too. This is before.
We went back in time.
You're ahead of me, Judge. I was confused by the time. Okay. You are now telling us about something of significance that happened before the injunction hearing.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm sorry. I'm on board. I apologize. Glad the judge caught that. Please continue.
The officer asked my son for the injunction papers, and she read them over, and she said, "You know, you're not supposed to, you know, they accuse you of pulling a knife on their son, on their dogs." And I said,
pulling a knife on their dog?
Yes, sir. So he said, "No, ma'am." He said, "I didn't." He said, "I was protecting myself." And he said, "Ma'am," he said, "we have it on video."
Objection. Your hearsay.
Without repeating what various people say, what happened in terms of that?
Okay. You want me to say what I heard or say?
No, I don't want you to repeat what somebody said. Okay. I want you to tell the court what the result of that interaction was.
Oh, the results were that the officer refused to watch the video and refused to listen to it. She refused a copy of it, and she got in her car and went back over to where they were.
Let me go back to the question that I asked, and just to make sure that I covered it. From the time of the injunction hearing up until the day of the shooting, is there anything of significance that you personally observed that we haven't covered in terms of interaction between your son and his family and the Blake group?
There was no interreaction between any of the groups. We stayed quiet on our side, and that's it.
Okay. Now, during that period of time, did you ever have any occasion to review any of the videotapes of the time periods when you weren't actually there during the same period of time?
No, sir, I didn't. I waited until everything was done.
Well, at any point in time, did you review the videotapes of that segment?
Yet, of which segment?
Time between the injunction hearing and the day of the shooting.
No, sir.
No, you did not. Okay.
I did not.
Did you yourself assist your son in any plans to move out of the neighborhood?
Yes, sir, we did.
Tell me how that occurred.
I went to see a very close friend from law enforcement, Bobby Mutter, and I asked him if he could possibly help in any way in relocating my son.
Now, let me stop for a moment. Mr. Mutter is a retired police officer.
Yes, sir, with Titusville.
And he's now a real estate agent.
Yes, sir.
Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Is that why you went to him as a real estate agent? I mean, I understand that he was a friend of yours back in your law enforcement days, but were you seeking his help as a law enforcement officer or as a realtor?
As a realtor.
Okay, I just wanted to clear that up.
Okay.
All right. After contacting Mr. Mutter, what steps did you take to assist your son in relocating?
The biggest step, I guess, we took was we went with our son to Bobby's office and told Bobby we didn't care what it cost to relocate our son anywhere outside this area or the immediate area of his neighborhood. If we can get 4 or 5 miles away, that's great. The further we can get and still be in town is what we're looking for. And we told him that was what it cost, and we'll take care of it.
Okay. And was he able to assist you and your son in finding a new location?
Yes, sir. The next afternoon, he found a place, and the next afternoon, which was Friday, he began assisting Barbara, Billy's wife, with financing to purchase another house probably 4 or 5 miles away in a completely different section of town. He ran through he continued to assist with the negotiations, the financing, and everything until he had the closing set up for them to leave.
What was the closing date, as best you recall?
I think it was going to be about 30 days. About 2 weeks to 30 days was what he was able to negotiate it down to. So that they had another 2 weeks that they had to, you know, had to be there until they could leave and go to that other house. And we couldn't find any rentals for them anywhere.
Yeah. What was your son's reaction to this plans to move?
To the what?
Plans to move. How was he reacting to it? Was he happy, sad, upset? What?
He was happy and sad. He didn't want to leave his house. He didn't want to leave the neighbors that he had become friends with. And
objection, this is all hearsay.
Just kidding.
Did you all, the actual date of the shooting, video we had, previously shown some video, and a trailer was identified in that video of the shooting. What was that trailer on the property for, if you know?
I'm sorry, I don't understand what the trailer...
Yeah, was there a trailer on the property, not your son's property, the night of the shooting, and what were you using that trailer?
Oh, a pull-behind trailer?
Yes.
That was his trailer, or our trailer.
And what were you going to use it for?
Well, we've been using it to haul dirt, rocks, brush. We were going to use it to haul furniture when he got ready to move, because we had each had a pickup truck and a trailer. So we had.
Is that why it was on the scene at that time, to help the move?
No, sir. It'd been at his house. He was using it more than I was, so he kept it at his house.
Okay.
Attended witness, thank you. Can we take a recess?
Yes, we can.